In the last video, we took a look at a proof of concept mock-up of a dust mask with an integrated eyewear to keep you safe while you're working in your shop. In this video, we're going to take a look at the further design process of this soft goods product. What is it going to take to make it manufacturable, different materials, colors, finishes, and make it look really great so that the consumer is going to want to buy it when they see it on the shelf.
My name is Eric Strebel. I'm an industrial designer. Welcome to my channel about product design and making. I hope that you like, enjoy, and become a subscriber.
Make sure you give the video a thumbs up, and then you hit the bell. Hit the bell again so you get the little parentheses around it. That way you'll be notified every time I have a new video. For phase two of this project, we're going to sketch right on top of one of the images from the proof of concept from the last design phase. So now we're taking a look at the aesthetics and the functionality and the manufacturability of such a product. We're going to have some vents for the person to breathe. That's something that the last mock-up or proof of concept did not have. We're going to take a look at manufacturability, how things kind of go together so that they are fit and finishes better. It's a little bit more comfortable, adjustability, how the glasses kind of attach, those sort of things, and materials, fit and finish look, and color in this phase. In a regular design project, you would probably take a look and explore multiple concepts instead of just one like we're doing here. So you would take a look at different styles and colors, materials, and finishes, that sort of thing. Before we move on with this project, I just want to let everybody know the design and making merchandise is here. T-shirts, hoodies, and stickers for your shop. It's my way of saying thank you for everybody's fantastic support and will help me continue to make awesome content. So super quick, the first thing I do is I 3D print out a plastic sort of mouth and nose piece. I use some basic dimensions that I measure just with a ruler, and I translate that into a piece so I can sort of see if my concept is gonna work, and it does appear that it's gonna work. I think in general, it's way too early in the design process to use modeling, CAD modeling, and 3D printing. The only reason that I go to CAD and 3D printing in this instance is because of this grill with the holes for the mesh. In hindsight, I probably should have just modeled a little mesh piece and built the thing out of cardboard. It would have given me a lot more flexibility, so either cardboard or like a styrene or something like that. I spent so much time modeling it in the computer that I don't think it was worth it, and it's something that I should have done by hand. Now, if you have the resources and you have a dedicated, you know, box jockey that's going to sit there and model your hand-waved sketches, then that's a different deal. Most designers don't have that flexibility, and I certainly don't. So we're just gonna print out the 3D piece here, and this is gonna give me my base piece that I'm gonna use and modify pretty heavily here as we move forward in the project. Scraping it off the 3D printer here, and we're gonna clean off all the support material on the backside real quick. Now, that being said, there is definitely an upside to 3D printing this part. It is a pretty strong piece. It's made out of PLA, and it's got some good structurability. It's symmetrical on both sides. I don't have to worry about that. So let's start working on the side pieces that are going to connect onto this mask. I'm using a piece of 3mm craft foam. You can buy this at any craft or hobby store. It's actually quite well suited for this kind of a project. It's flexible, it has some strength, so as an alternative material to leather, which I don't think is an option really for a kind of a budget dust mask in this case, I think this type of a foam is a good material to sort of simulate some sort of a flexible material, maybe like a TPU or a silicone or something like that in this case. So modifying the mouthpiece here to make it fit my face a little bit better, and I clean things up with a file. I like using files instead of sandpaper. They're flat, straight,
and they give you nice surface finish, and I feel like a little bit less dust and just a little bit more control over the surface that you're finishing. All right, I want to talk a little bit about the colors that I've chosen here, and you'll see I've chosen a white material, and some of you would say, oh my gosh, a white dust mask, but you know, that's quite a common thing, actually. They're very cheap dust masks. They're all white sort of material, and I am definitely going for a little bit more of a sci-fi kind of menacing kind of look. Maybe something from like a Final Fantasy or whatever, where I'm gonna attempt to do this dust mask in some lighter, more space type colors, and thus the silver that I chose for the grill and the white for the sides. And I really like that kind of look. It's not super dark. It also reads better on film, of course. So we're gonna start to attach the straps, and I can simply sew right through that foam material onto the straps. Works halfway decent. Just be careful here when you're using this kind of stretchy material. It's pretty tricky to sew. You really gotta push it underneath the foot of your machine if you don't have a walking foot machine. I mean, it's stretchy and it doesn't grab really great onto the teeth on the bottom. All right. At this point, we want to do a kind of a test fit to see if things are going to start to work out in terms of the side pieces, how they get mounted onto the mouth and nose piece. I'm going to use some double-sided sticky tape here to merely attach the foam onto the printed part. All right, we're going to use these off-the-shelf one-way valves. These are the valves that allow the person to breathe or exhale out while using the mask. Okay, so that looks pretty good, actually. Fits onto my head quite well. Allows me to breathe and creates a halfway decent seal across my face. You'll see that little bend in the side of the mask causes the foam to create a little void and the vents to actually work. A production mask like this would have a filter, and so I'm using some filter material here that I am basically just sewing up, and this is going to go right in front of the mouth, and in this case I'm just going to pop it in. For production, you probably have some sort of a frame or something that you could lock this down with and be interchangeable to use and be replaceable. But for right now, we're just going to set it in there. So let's work with some Bondo here, some polyester body filler, to attach the eyewear to the nose bridge part, very much in the same way that we built the proof of concept mock-up. We're basically using the glasses as a guide or a squeeze, and we're letting the polyester body filler set up around it so that we can move the eyewear in and out and have it be replaceable. This would also be like a production feature. So this area, I purposely didn't model it because I knew that this is going to take too much time. It's going to be so much easier just to do it in Bondo, and it's going to give me so much more flexibility in terms of design, figuring out the exact form of everything, and it's just going to be so much quicker for me to do this than modeling in the computer, and give me so much more flexibility. Things are starting to come together, especially with the body filler here. It gives me a ton of options, and it lets me explore the form in this nose area, which I really wasn't happy with before. First up, we're gonna repaint these one-way vents. We're gonna put a little bit of primer on them, and ultimately we're gonna paint them like a blue color, a blue-gray. But they need a little bit of primer so that the paint will actually adhere to them. Okay, while I was painting those, the polyester set up and it kind of got away from me a little bit, so I'm going to get out a little, or an old bandsaw blade here, and I'm just going to saw through to get some of these flat plane surfaces back. Normally I would do that when the material is all kind of rubbery and I can just cut it with a knife. I like using files that I mentioned before. They are fantastic for getting nice flat surfaces and great way to quickly rough in surfaces. So for plastic or wood or plaster, I find them a fantastic way to do things by hand. You'll see I have a right and a left version, and I really like the left version a lot better, a little more chiseled look. I find the right side is a little bit too heavy, so I'm going to duplicate that over, and I'm going to put some Bondo onto the mask where it needs it so I can make both sides symmetrical. And again, this is what I sort of like about doing hands-on stuff, is it gives you the option to test and model stuff as you go on the fly. If you have that time and flexibility, I find it just so much better than doing stuff in the computer, because that just takes so much time, where I think this is a quick, fast, and easy way to come up with design variations and test out different things and see what you like. You know, the car guys do this all the time. They're using clay, and I just love to have that flexibility to be able to change things on the fly and make adjustments as needed. So when the body filler is still pretty soft, it's super easy to sculpt it with a knife here or a very rough file. And I like using that. It's a very easy, quick way to do that. You also notice I have a piece of tape down that I put down on the PLA 3D printed parts so that I don't get any polyester into the lines, the print lines. Next, I switch right to a file and I rough in all my surfaces that way. I just find it infinitely easier than using this piece of sandpaper that ultimately gets clogged up. The files are easy to clean with a brush if they get clogged, and you can just keep on going and they stay sharper for so much longer. After the file, I'm going to switch to a card scraper. It's basically a piece of spring steel. Again, the car guys use this all the time to sculpt their clay, and I find it a great tool. I use it actually a lot on 3D prints, just for cleaning up 3D prints instead of sandpaper. Stays sharp for a long time, and it's just really easy to use. Ultimately, I am switching to a piece of sandpaper, and I use 120 grit, so it's pretty rough. I want the texture of the body filler to at least be close to the texture of the 3D printed part. So I don't want it to be too smooth, and so I'm okay with some of the scratches and rough surface that is left. I use a paint marker here in silver to just paint everything up. That way I don't have to mask anything off and spray paint it, just infinitely quicker. The silver matches the printed color of the silver quite well. We're gonna use some glue here to glue the foam pieces directly onto the 3D printed part. Now that it's finished, I'm gonna use some E6000, a fantastic glue for something like this. You could certainly use contact cement as well. I just don't have any, so I use this to bond everything together and some clamps to hold it while it dries, and this works out quite well. I'm going to make a little leather piece that goes on the strap that goes over your head, just to give the strap a little bit of flexibility or slidability for when you put it over your head, so that you can easily get it and not snag it on your hair, and just have some adjustability. I use some white leather here, thinking that it's going to match the foam that I have. And it's close. It's more of a cream, and I don't like it. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to paint it, which, you know, most leather is. You just don't realize it. I'm going to paint it to match those vents, and we use the same color paint. Pretty light coats. I don't need anything super heavy duty here. I want to make sure that the edges get painted as well. I basically just put this in my spray booth here and then put a piece of plastic bag over the rest of the mask, and I tape off the elastic straps as well so they don't get all blue. And little clips get painted blue as well, and so it has a really nice different kind of look and feel from any sort of traditional mask that you might buy in a big box retail store. So that's as far as I'm going to take this project for phase two.
If you are a manufacturer of safety wear, dust masks, that sort of thing, respirators, if you're 3M, hey, you want to license this project or finish the project with me to license it, bring it to market, feel free to reach out. If you're a manufacturer of other consumer products and you're looking for an industrial designer for your next future project, feel free to reach out as well. I'd be happy to write you a quote for any type of consumer product that you're interested in having me work on. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel. You can do that by clicking on the icon in the bottom right of the video or below the video. Give it a thumbs up and follow the channel there as well. Want to know about upcoming design content and projects that I'm working on? Follow me on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and my favorite Google+. Links below. Also, don't forget to check out all the design and making gear below. Rock on. Click here to check out some of the other design and making videos that I have that you might enjoy.